Let's take a body which is moving with a certain angular velocity and angular acceleration with point O2 as the axis of rotation. We can consider point A at that body too. And if there's a certain point B is coincident with that point A, and that point B is moving along this path in body 2, then the acceleration of point B can be given by this equation. The acceleration of point B is equal to the acceleration of A plus the acceleration of B with respect to A plus the Coriolis component of acceleration. Now, what does this mean? It means that the components of the acceleration of B include the acceleration of point A, and that means we have to hold B on this body and allow this body to move and determine the acceleration of that point. Now this one, we have to hold body 2 is stationary and allow point B to move along that path. And then finally we have a Coriolis component of acceleration. The Coriolis component of acceleration will exist if there is a certain point moving about a certain body while that body is also moving. So in this case, let us have a body 2, this body 2, and it is moving around point O. The velocity of that particular point A can easily be determined by our equation omega 2 times O to A. The acceleration of point A has two components, the normal and the tangential. Now, if there is another point B coincident to point A, and that point B is moving on that body along a certain path, and it has a certain velocity B with respect to A, then the total acceleration now to point B can be given by this equation. Acceleration of B normal, acceleration of B tangential, although sometimes we cannot distinguish the components, we will just be knowing total acceleration of point B. This acceleration of point B is now equal to the acceleration of A normal plus the acceleration of A tangential. So that means we have to move to allow the motion of this particular body while holding B stationary in that point and determine the acceleration of that point A. Those two acceleration magnitude are this. And so with that, we will have the acceleration of B with respect to A normal plus the acceleration of B with respect to A tangential. And that means we have to hold B stationary and allow point B to move along the path. Now, there is another component of acceleration, which is the Coriolis component of acceleration. And we can now proceed with the calculation of all the other magnitude of the acceleration. And for whatever problem we may be given, then we can easily understand and determine the various magnitudes of the other acceleration components. After our two introduction of the various components of acceleration, including the Coriolis component, we will now concentrate only on the Coriolis component of acceleration. And we still have this body 2. The body 2 has an angular acceleration, an angular velocity around 0.2. And that body 2 contains 0.A. At 0.A there is a certain part along which point B is moving. So point B is moving along the path with a velocity B in the respect to A. So the total acceleration of point B is now given as the acceleration of B normal and the acceleration of B tangential equal to the acceleration of A plus the acceleration of acceleration of A normal and acceleration of A tangential plus the acceleration of B with respect to A normal and the acceleration of B with respect to A tangential plus the Coriolis component of acceleration. But in fact, most of our problems that we will encounter, that we will be encountering later, the Coriolis component of acceleration can easily be solved. But what we really have to find out are the acceleration of A tangential or the acceleration of B with respect to A tangential, or sometimes the acceleration of B tangential. Now, the Coriolis component of acceleration has this magnitude, 2 multiplied by omega 2. Omega 2 is the angular velocity of the path. And the velocity of B with respect to A, or the relative velocity of point B with respect to A along that path. Now, if we know the magnitude, we still have to determine the acceleration, the direction of acceleration. And there are 4 possible directions of this Coriolis component. In this case, where the velocity of B with respect to A is along that direction, and the angular velocity of this is in the clockwise direction, the velocity component of the acceleration of the Coriolis component of acceleration is almost this. It is perpendicular to the relative velocity and to the direction of the angular velocity. Now, it is possible to have this moving in counterclockwise direction. In that case, the Coriolis component of acceleration will now be perpendicular to this vector, but directed upwards. Again, following our rule that it follows the direction of the angular velocity. Another case, that is the third case, is when this velocity, the relative velocity of A with respect to B, is along that direction. So the component of Coriolis, the Coriolis component of acceleration, is now directed towards this direction again, as we have to follow the rule that it has to be 90 degrees from that vector and towards the direction, along the towards the direction of the angular velocity, and it is to be in the counterclockwise direction. So this is the direction of the Coriolis component of acceleration. And the last case is when this is towards the clockwise direction again, and with that we can rotate this vector and find that the Coriolis component of acceleration is again directed upward. So with that, we can now proceed with the discussion of some problems with which we can apply this principle, where the Coriolis component of acceleration determines a lot, affects a lot the totality of the Coriolis, of the components of the acceleration of the other parts of the body.